guys know what happened in Tulsa in 1921? How much do you know about the race riots?
I don't know a lot about them.
What do you know about it?
Not much.
No idea the extent of what happened, though.
Not really.
Was it ever taught in school? Did you ever hear people talking about that around here?
Well, I mean, I knew about it because I went to predominantly black schools. But on a global scale, as far as Oklahoma, no, it's not widely mentioned.
You guys know what happened here in 1921?
Tulsa race riot.
How much do you know about the race riots?
I don't know, just only what I found out for myself.
You know, in some ways people look at it as life change for some of the Tulsa's Americans and for Tulsa itself. So,
but in other ways?
In other ways, life.
I'm Art Fennell. One of the worst atrocities in U.S. history was hidden for decades. It happened over a 24-hour period from the early evening of May 30th, 1921, till dusk of June the 1st. And it happened here in Tulsa, Oklahoma. This town erupted into a deadly race riot that's regarded as one of the most violent and destructive ever in America. Yet, few people know anything about it. Greenwood, the prospering African-American section of town, was torched and burned to the ground in a bloody rampage by an angry mob of thousands of whites. The exact number of casualties and property damage still unknown, even now. What happened here? Why was Tulsa and this community at the boiling point that they felt that the whites needed to send a message to the segregated blacks? And why was this event covered up for 80 years? Let's go back in time in Tulsa to find out. On June 2nd, 1921, one day after the riots subsided, a reporter for the Tulsa Daily World wrote,
"On the steps of the few houses that remained sat feeble and gray Negro men and women, and occasionally a small child. The look in their eyes was one of dejection and supplication. Judging from their attitude, it was not of material consequence to them whether they lived or died. Harmless themselves, they apparently could not conceive the brutality and fiendishness of men who would deliberately set fire to their homes and just as deliberately shoot them down in their tracks."
To understand why the riots occurred, you have to look at the tumultuous history of Oklahoma and Tulsa. The riots were not an isolated event. Instead, they were the outbreak from years of buildup. In 1830, newly elected President Andrew Jackson signed the Indian Removal Act, which provided him the power to negotiate with Indian tribes east of the Mississippi River. The purpose of the negotiations was to encourage Indians to leave their land and to move to the sparsely inhabited land west of the Mississippi River. Some tribes agreed to pick up their lives and leave. The tribes that were unwilling to negotiate were forced to move. An aggressive approach backed by the United States military. It would take nearly 30 years to relocate Indians to the West. The 25 million acres of land west of the Mississippi River was up for grabs. A majority of white settlers who were not interested in sharing the land with Indians, in fact, wanted to establish slave states. The Homestead Act of 1862 legally opened the West for those seeking land. The Homestead Act provided an individual with 160 acres of unoccupied public land in exchange for eventual payment. A territory known as Oklahoma quickly became a popular destination.
Historians have always said history is a lie agreed upon.
Tulsa author and historian Eddie Faye Gates contends that many parts of Oklahoma had already by now been long occupied by migrating blacks who lived in scattered villages without official town charters. But land-grabbing whites simply discarded them.
It's part of the philosophy that black people just didn't count, no matter where you were, Africa, Asia, Indian, here in the Louisiana Territory where they were, they still just counted as inferior people.
White towns and colonies continued to spring up, and in 1907, Oklahoma became the 46th state in the Union. But by now, 20 all-black towns were also established in this new state of Oklahoma, and many of these were Southern blacks who had fled the oppressive Jim Crow South to build their new lives in the Western Promised Land.
Order in the court.
But when the Oklahoma legislature was established, the state passed Senate Bill 1, which would quickly put blacks in their place by legalizing segregation. This prohibited blacks from voting and severely limited other privileges as where they could live and attend school. Legalized separation, however, did not prevent violence from happening in Tulsa prior to the riots. Between the years of 1907 and 1921, 26 blacks were lynched in the state of Oklahoma. The all-black communities became easy targets for assaults from white mobs, and organized groups like the Ku Klux Klan, though still young, were given free rein and rule from town officials.
Tulsa was a Saturday night town. People got paid their weekly salaries. They come downtown to buy their clothing and everything. So it was a big crowd down every Saturday night in town. The mayor and the chief of police made the people stick their cars off of the street, and occasionally the Klan would parade down Main Street with the torches and the white robes and everything. It was pretty scary. I wished I had a picture to show you.
These white citizens' groups were sending a clear message to Oklahoma's black citizens. We don't want you here. And if you stay, you'd best know your place. Before the 1921 riots, Tulsa, Oklahoma was a little-known railroad town.
It was the railroad stop at the Arkansas River, because there was no bridge across the river then. So they came to the river and it stopped, and this was just the end of the line for a few years.
But Tulsa's fortunes would dramatically change when word of oil began to spread. A city built on oil money couldn't remain a secret.
Well, it just blew up. We had oil all around here. And many of the big oil companies were started here.
Tulsa picked up the nickname of Magic City, a boom town where people began to flood the streets in search of jobs and fortune. In 1910, Tulsa's population was 10,000. By 1920, The city had exploded to 100,000, 10,000 of which were African Americans. Many of the blacks in Tulsa were doctors, lawyers, businessmen, and educators. But because of segregation, they weren't allowed to work with the white mainstream population. So they created their own jobs and their own city within a city. Black Tulsans were forced to live on the other side of the Frisco tracks. This section would be called Greenwood, founded by O.W. Gurley. Gurley was a wealthy black Arkansas landowner and entrepreneur who settled in Oklahoma in 1889. Gurley's Greenwood would become so prosperous, so fast, that it was called the Black Wall Street, perhaps the most successful African-American business district in the nation at that time.
Prior to integration, and that's when Tulsa's Wall Street was the Wall Street, we did have a lot of businesses, especially in the South. I've later found this out, that they were black businesses because blacks had no choice but to deal with each other.
These black Tulsans in this photograph ran their own businesses, restaurants, hotels, jewelry stores, clothing shops, taxi services, theaters, newspapers, and much more. They worked well, worshiped well. There were more churches in Black Greenwood than all of the rest of white Tulsa combined. And they lived well. Many of their homes rivaled those of wealthy whites in the area.
Oh, they were dressed. They were dressed. And they had beautiful homes, big pianos. They had curtains hanging from Belgium, furniture from Europe. They had it shipped over. This was black folks. Whites were jealous of all this. In fact, some were quoted as saying, these niggers have better things than we do.
The prosperous times in Tulsa, however, didn't go unnoticed by white authorities, because for all the praying the blacks did on Sunday morning, they also did plenty of partying on Saturday night.
We were just having a big time.
Otis Clark is 104 years old and still remembers well that though it was the Prohibition era and the entire nation was supposedly dry, it didn't take much to find alcohol in Tulsa.
We had that corn whiskey. We didn't have no whole lot of different fancy chickens, bit whiskey like they got now.
Yeah.
We just had old corn whiskey, and we had to drink our corn whiskey and go to the show.
Oh, it flowed. There's no question about it. But the bootleggers, they got kind of smart. They'd make you, there was some bad whiskey. I don't say bad, but I mean, some brands were cheap. And the liquor stores would make them buy this cheap brand along with the other liquor.
Illegal drugs were plentiful too. Cocaine, morphine, and opium were the drugs of choice. But prostitution was the pleasure of choice. In 1921, an undercover agent spent 5 days in Tulsa and concluded,
"Vice conditions in this city are extremely bad. Gambling, bootlegging, and prostitution are very much in evidence. At the leading hotels and rooming houses, the bellhops and porters are pimping for women and also selling booze. These prostitutes and pimps solicit without any fear of the police."
Adding fuel to the flames, the prostitutes were mostly white women. The pimps were mostly black men. One former judge stated,
"We've got to kick out the Negro pimps if we want to stop this vice."
Typical, the intermingling. People knew it, but they didn't like it.
Having relations with a white woman was enough to get a black man hanged. But for some, apparently, the racial harmony was worth the risk. A reporter for the Tulsa Tribune found a roadhouse outside of Tulsa where he wrote these words.
Whites and Negroes were singing and dancing together. Young white girls were dancing while Negroes played the piano.
Working class whites didn't like seeing or hearing this news. Add to that, the oil and manufacturing jobs were beginning to wane, and whites were getting laid off. The animosity towards blacks was building, and Tulsa was on the verge of its darkest hour.
Thank you.
On the eve of Memorial Day 1921, an incident in this building, the Drexel Building in downtown Tulsa, would trigger the worst race riot in American history. On the fourth floor was a restroom for coloreds only. Dick Rowland, a 19-year-old black shoeshine man called a boot black, entered the building to use the restroom. Sarah Page, a 17-year-old white girl, operated the elevator in the building. Something happened inside that elevator that caused Page to scream and set off a string of events that led to the destruction of Greenwood. Some believe Rowland tripped upon entering the elevator and grabbed Page's arm to balance himself. Others believe he perhaps stepped on her foot, prompting Page to scream. The most extreme belief is that Rowland attempted to rape Page in the elevator. And there's another account, corroborated by people who knew Rowland, that the two not only knew each other, but had been lovers.
So according to one of the ladies I interviewed, Mama Alice, so she babysat Dick Rowland, and she knew the girl, the elevator girl. She said they were boyfriend and girlfriend. She knew that.
Regardless of what happened in the elevator, Page screamed. Rowland ran out. A clothing store clerk witnessed Rowland leaving the building and apparently heard Page scream. The clerk believed that Page had been sexually assaulted and summoned police. And though Page never brought charges against Rowland, he was arrested in the morning. All day on May 31st, word spread that a young white woman had been victimized by a black man. At 3 p.m., in the afternoon edition of the Tulsa Tribune newspaper, an openly racist paper at the time that referred to Greenwood as, quote, Niggertown, the flames were fanned by a hastily printed, instigative front page article titled, Nab Negro for Attacking Girl in Elevator. Even though there was no evidence, the article stated that Rowland attacked her, scratched her hands and face, and tearing her clothes. Once the Tribune hit the streets, reaction amongst the whites was unanimous. According to Ross T. Warner, a manager at the Tulsa Machine and Tool Company, the talk of lynching spread like prairie fire. Rowland was held at the Tulsa County Courthouse. Just as the sun was setting at about 7:30, a crowd of hundreds gathered there, demanding that Rowland be released. The mob wanted Rowland to be freed so they could lynch him. Fortunately for Dick Rowland, Tulsa had just elected a new sheriff, Willard M. McCullough. McCullough was determined to maintain order at the courthouse and placed armed deputies around the building. Word of a mad mob gathering to lynch Rowland quickly spread to Greenwood as well. Blacks were determined not to stand idly by. Many of them had just returned home from World War I and were ready to help defend Rowland from a rope.
They said, they will not lynch on our watch. We will not have it.
At 9 o'clock, 25 of the men armed themselves with shotguns and rifles and marched to the courthouse to offer their support to authorities. But their offer was turned down, and they left. Within 30 minutes, the crowd outside the courthouse continued to gather, and by now had doubled to 2,000. At 10 o'clock, a second wave of 75 black men went back to the courthouse to offer help once again. But this time, they were confronted by the growing mob, who had been drinking heavily for hours. Shots rang out, and when the smoke had cleared, 12 men lay dead. Outgunned and severely outmanned, the blacks fled back to Greenwood, pursued by members of the mob. Dr. George H. Miller heard the gunshots outside his office, and he ran to find a bleeding black man and said this.
I went over to see if I could help him as a doctor, but the crowd was gathering around him and wouldn't even let the driver of the ambulance, which just arrived, pick him up. The crowd was getting more and more belligerent. The Negro had been shot so many times in his chest, and men from the onlookers were slashing him with knives.
The situation grew worse by the minute. By midnight, about 500 men and boys from the mob were sworn in as special deputies at police headquarters and given badges. One of the new deputies, Laurel G. Buck, stated that police officers told the new recruits to get a gun and get a nigger. By 1 a.m., the white mob began setting fire to black homes and businesses. The first wave of Tulsa firefighters were kept at bay by armed rioters. And in other instances, the Tulsa Fire Department did nothing to extinguish the flames. Herbert Johnson was a supervisor with the fire department. He was also an admitted member of the Ku Klux Klan. Throughout the night, Greenwood burned and blacks were hunted down and shot on sight. One group of rioters broke into an elderly couple's home. The husband and wife were praying. The rioters shot them in the back of their heads. At about 5 a.m., the remaining black men who had guns made a last stand for their lives to protect their family and themselves by retreating up Standpipe Hill, an elevated perch just off of Greenwood Avenue. Though they are said to have fought gallantly, the machine gun fire eventually overwhelmed them. By daybreak on June 1st, Greenwood was still in flames, but through the smoke hovering in the city, the dim early morning light began to reveal the horror. The slain bodies of many black Tulsans were scattered in the streets.
I will never forget the awful things I saw that day. Oh, the terrible ruins and the smell of burning flesh. I can shut my eyes and still smell that flesh.
Through the night, blacks had hid as best they could, but daybreak was a chance to try and get to the railroad to get out of town. But fleeing the city was just as dangerous as remaining behind. A group of white men had set up machine guns on top of a grain elevator. They had a clear shot of Greenwood Avenue. Dumple Bush recounts the horrors of escaping Greenwood. It was just dawn. The machine guns were sweeping the valley with their murderous fire, and my heart was filled with dread as we sped along. Old men, women, and children were running and screaming everywhere.
Somebody come running down the alley and get up and get out of your house, because they're going to burn your house down and kill you and burn you down while you're in it. And say, don't stop to get anything. Just get up and get out of what you got on your back.
Elwood Lett, he was 6 years old, and his grandpa got the horse and the wagon and was going to try to go drive up to Coweta for safety. He said he heard a man come up to his grandpa and said, "Nigger, where are you going?" He said, "I'm going up to Coweta. I've got a farm up there." And Elwood said he couldn't help but lift up and look. And he said he wished he had not looked, because the last thing he saw was that guy with a gun to his grandpa's head. He said, "The hell you will." Bam, bam, bam. Three shots in the head.
By now, whites had also taken to the sky, using planes to shoot down on Greenwood. And at least one plane reportedly bombed the fleeing residents below with homemade Molotov cocktails, creating even more panic and chaos in the streets. Thelma Knight was just 5 years old and says the riots were the last time she ever saw her father. The question of what happened to him, never to be answered.
I never saw him no more.
After the night of the riots, when you were 4 years old,
I never saw him anymore.
Never heard another word.
You didn't ask too many questions in that day and time, if you heard. You know they'll tell you stay in your place.
If the night of May 31st was the riot, then the morning of June 1st was the invasion. Members of the Tulsa National Guard were on the scene, but their orders were not to quell the mob. Instead, they had been told to stop a Negro uprising. The Guard rounded up and arrested any blacks in sight and took them to internment camps. But even as the blacks surrendered and were paraded through the streets with their hands up, some were still shot in cold blood. Dr. Andrew C. Jackson was one of them. Dr. Jackson was a renowned surgeon in Greenwood who was acknowledged by the world-famous Mayo Brothers of the Mayo Clinic as the finest Negro surgeon in America. With his house in flames, Dr. Jackson surrendered to the sheriff's special deputies and was offered their protection, only to be shot twice in the back. Philip Ree says he was 8 years old at the time the blacks were herded right past his house by the National Guard. Ree says he felt so bad for the blacks that he hid under his porch with his little BB gun and started shooting at the National Guardsmen to try and make them leave the blacks alone. With the men either dead or arrested, their homes were vulnerable. Pillaging whites destroyed and looted from the blacks at will with no one to stop them. Dr. R.T. Bridgewater said of his home,
I saw my piano and all of my elegant furniture piled in the street. My safe had been broken open, all of the money stolen, also my silverware, cut glass, all of the family clothes and everything of value had been removed, even my family Bible.
Oh, I remember vividly.
Dr. Olivia Hooker was just a little girl, but vividly recalls when the invading whites came to her home.
The morning of the riot, I heard this noise, pip, 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 hitting the house. So I said to my mother, how can it be hailing when the sun is shining? And my mother said, come with me. And she peeped through the shades and showed me, said, you see that thing up there on top of the hill? I said, yeah, that's a machine gun. And there, you see the American flag on top of it. That means your government is shooting at you. Now, this was a terribly distressing to a six-year-old. And I thought, why would my government shoot at me? Then they came in the house. You see, but my mother didn't flee. Everybody else ran. My mother said, I'm gonna pour water on and keep my house from burning. So we were still in there. And they destroyed my grandmother's sewing machine. They poured oil on her bed and set fire. They broke everything they couldn't take.
The violence, looting, and burning of buildings and homes spread so quickly that the Tulsa police couldn't keep up. The few police officers who were on the streets were scattered across the city, and the mob's numbers now were rumored to be somewhere between 5 and 10,000. And if any African Americans protested or put up a fight, they were killed. Even completely helpless people were killed. E.W. Maxey told how a blind man with amputated legs was murdered.
These white thugs had roped a colored man on the longest stump of his one leg and were dragging him behind the car up Main Street. He was hollering, his head being bashed in, bouncing on the steel rails and bricks.
By 8 p.m. on June 1st, roughly 24 hours after the riots began, the atrocity concluded. Greenwood, with the thriving businesses, marvelous architecture, and beautiful homes, looked like a war zone. The Black Wall Street was reduced to charred remains. 35 city blocks destroyed. Hundreds murdered, 10,000 now homeless, a legacy erased. Yet, not a single white home or church was touched. City officials moved quickly to cover the atrocity before the outside media could learn of it. They initially listed the number of casualties at 36, including blacks and whites, but eyewitnesses give a dramatically different count.
Our version was 312, and we do have the documentation to prove it. We've got the record.
Clyde Eddy and his friend saw bodies too and knows where they were quickly buried before they could be discovered.
I lived at 10th and Quaker, which is a block from the Oakland Cemetery. So we walked past the cemetery and there was a whole big bunch of eight or nine great big packing crates, wooden packing crates. And there's about eight or 10 men digging a big pit. Went over to raise the first lid, and there were about three or four bodies in it. Went over to the next one, there was about four more bodies in there. And there was about six or seven more boxes. About that time, this guy comes over and he says, you boys leave, you got no business in here. So we left and went outside the cemetery and stood and watched through the gate, through the fence, and watched them bury about 20-some bodies. No caskets, no nothing, just buried it.
Even to this day, a small unmarked cross represents the spot of the mass grave in Oakland Cemetery. It's believed there may also have been as many as four other unmarked mass graves around Tulsa as well. But other victims weren't afforded the time or effort for even a hasty burial, but were rather subjected to a watery grave. Other eyewitnesses tell of mass bodies being dumped by the truckloads into the Arkansas River. Men with vibrant lives and families violently snuffed out, then discarded like meaningless debris, never to be seen or heard from again. If the purpose of the riot was to punish one black man for allegedly assaulting a white woman, it was quickly lost in the chaos. Tulsa was brimming with racial tension, and the white rioters didn't hesitate to displace the African-American population. This continued after the riots. An ordinance was passed by the city preventing Greenwood residents from rebuilding their own businesses in the district. The Reconstruction Commission, consisting of white business owners and political leaders, denied outside aid to the Greenwood residents. The Tulsa Tribune led the fight when it ran this scathing editorial on June 4th, 1921.
Such a district as Old Niggertown must never be allowed in Tulsa again. It was a cesspool of iniquity and corruption. In this Old Niggertown were a lot of bad niggers, and a bad nigger is about the lowest thing that walks on 2 feet. Give a bad nigger his booze and his dope and a gun, and he thinks he can shoot up the world. All these four things were to be found in Niggertown: booze, dope, bad niggers, and guns.
The Tulsa Tribune, Saturday, June 4th, 1921. When the riots became a legal issue in late June of 1921, the grand jury blamed it all on the blacks. It concluded,
"The recent race riot was the direct result of an effort on the part of certain colored men. We have not been able to find any evidence, either from white or colored citizens, that any organized attempt was made or planned to take any prisoner, the crowd assembled about the courthouse being purely spectators and curiosity seekers. There was no mob spirit among the whites, no talk of lynching, and no arms. The assembly was quiet until the arrival of armed Negroes, which precipitated and was the direct cause of the entire affair."
The level of intimidation was severe. I mean, it was tremendous. So there's no way that African Americans could realistically, back in 1921, challenge what had happened to them.
Not only were African American veterans blamed, but a few were even brought up on charges. No whites ever suffered the same fate. This prompted ongoing fierce legal battle to defend the blacks who had been blamed and the thousands who had been victimized and wronged. Three prominent black attorneys from Greenwood set up a makeshift office in a little tent to handle the cases. From this makeshift tent, P.A. Chappelle, I.H. Spears, and B.C. Franklin handled $4 million in riot claims against the city of Tulsa. Some of the claims were as small as $120, but it was all that they had. Noted historian Dr. John Hope Franklin is B.C. Franklin's son.
He was establishing his law office in a tent. The black partisan had been razed to level. It was nothing but ashes. Place he got for us to live was gone. Everything else was gone. And he was practicing law in a tent, suing the city, suing the state, suing the insurance companies, trying to do something to get remuneration for his clients.
Any attention that the riot received immediately afterwards was superseded by the efforts to try and erase it going forward. Records disappeared. Newspaper headlines vanished. People moved away and stopped talking. The state history books omitted it as if this tragedy had never occurred.
You know, it was just never mentioned. You just didn't talk about it. So it was, nothing happened at all. No one said anything. Newspapers didn't report it. It was never mentioned. Just everybody wanted to forget it. The whites were embarrassed, and the blacks were not real secure.
And it was covered up because the powers that be were embarrassed. Some of them were definitely involved, would have been, could have been held accountable for a punishment. Those who create history create, they're the ones in control. The reason it was covered up was because the very ones who could have done this were the ones who did the riot. Boy Scout leaders, teachers, the mayor of Tulsa, the mayor, the police chief.
In 1997, 76 years later, a movement was started to mend the breach and set the record straight. The state established the Oklahoma Commission to study the Tulsa Race Riot of 1921. Members consisted of scholars, civic leaders, Tulsa citizens, and riot survivors. The commission's responsibility were twofold. One, determine exactly what happened in 1921, and two, assess if the victims should be compensated for damages they received at the hands of a city governed to protect them, but woefully aggrieved them.
It's almost hard to quantify, really, the damage economically that occurred, not only, you know, not to mention the sort of spiritual and emotional and psychological damage that has been done to people who have witnessed, you know, really a terror attack. You know, I mean, it's an act of terrorism on a community that went unchecked. The descendants and even the survivors themselves had businesses destroyed. I mean, thousands of homes were razed to the ground. You had a dozen churches. You had schools. You had libraries. You had, you know, a commercial district.
At first, the commission struggled to find resources to analyze what actually occurred during the riots. Fortunately, many survivors began to resurface and share their stories. Records and newspapers assumed to be lost were recovered. The riot commission assembled the definitive account of what happened. They compiled a detailed report and released it in 2001 with a recommendation of reparations for the victims. The commission concluded that reparations to the historic Greenwood community in real and tangible form would be a good public policy and do much to repair the emotional and physical scars.
Easily, you could do something to make some kind of meaningful repair for this group of people. You could have scholarships. You could have, you know, certainly some kind of grant of money. There's a lot that could be done to sort of build and empower that community to make some sort of type of restitution.
The only fair thing to do is not only apologize, but to actually do into repair. And that opens up the door to reparations. And if you ever open up that door, when you look at the inhumane treatment of blacks from Africa and what took place for 400 years, sanctioned by the government, sanctioned by the religious institutions in this country. I mean, you open up a Pandora's box that nobody wants to even look at.
This, however, isn't the first time the idea of reparations had been raised in Tulsa. In August of 1921, just 2 months after the riots, attorney and riot survivor H.A. Guess wrote, "Reparations will restore confidence of those whose faith has been seriously shaken." But 80 years later, riot survivors still have their faith, but no confidence at all that their claims will ever be acknowledged.
If it didn't want to do nothing for us, we done been to court, and Oklahoma's not gonna do it anyway. I'm gonna tell you like that. That's the way I feel about it.
You don't have much confidence in
nope,
the state.
Nope. I've been here all this time, but I've seen too much happen. I don't believe it.
We Oklahoma folks still have some of that little race hatred, and in that part of the country, they don't want to give over. They never want to give up. But colored lost a whole lot, so we had lost. Our little city was really ruined.
Survivors like Wes Young have offered different ideas for reparations.
I would like to see them get up a fund and put up a health clinic. Not a clinic, but a whole operation. Clinic, nursing school, or doctor school, which would be standing there 100 years from now. See, it could be a monument, not only to Tulsa and Oklahoma, but it would be a shining example of what we could have did.
Reparations have been awarded in the past. Japanese Americans that were sent to internment camps during World War II were allocated $20,000 by the United States Supreme Court in 1988. Tulsa's situation was different because few survivors were still living, and so much of the damage was previously ignored or denied. The commission understood this and recommended the following reparation measures: direct payment to survivors or survivor descendants, create a scholarship fund, build a memorial in honor of the victims and survivors of the riot, and establish an economic development project in Greenwood. To this day, no reparations have been paid. The state of Oklahoma has allocated $5 million to the construction of a memorial in Tulsa, but the project has been tied up for years. There is, however, this monument outside the Greenwood Cultural Center. Black granite with names engraved of those who suffered, those who died, details of what happened, and accounts of what was lost. Inside the cultural center are photos that document the day and images of people who lived through the horror. Inside the surviving block of the former Black Wall Street, the heart of Greenwood, signs identify the historical significance of the district. And on the sidewalk, placards mark the spot of what once was so many years ago. But the exterior restorations here can't begin to make the survivors whole. So much time has been lost, so many memories recalled, so much pain endured.
They haven't been fair.
Hasn't been fair.
Really? Because some people really need the help. They could do it to help everything else. And we had to start from scratch when we started back after the riot. You might not have had much, but it was more than you had had.
That wasn't right at all. See, that's the devil did that. He made the folks envious against one another. And in there, there wasn't nothing to it from the very beginning.
Today, a dedicated group of lawyers, scholars, and activists are fighting for the state or national government to follow through with the suggested reparations as defined by the commission, despite the long-expired statute of limitations. It's a fight that was taken all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court.
The courts have the power and they have the discretion to toll the statute of limitations where there are extraordinary circumstances. And unfortunately, in this case, the courts have not decided in our favor, have not seen it appropriate to toll the statute of limitations up to the point where this would be a viable lawsuit.
This is an important, historic, and tragic incident in the history of our country. And as a country, we have an obligation to remember our history and not to brush unpleasant incidents, even tragic incidents, under the rug.
The survivors who were left travel the country telling their story at packed symposiums like this one at Temple University, where legal scholars review and discuss and debate manners of recourse even now.
I hope the students who are here at Temple and other places will pay very close attention to this, because we always read cases about decisions already made in history. And here is a case study about the opportunity to affect history.
But they know that time is not on their side. The few survivors who remain are all in their 90s and beyond, and they count their blessings each and every day.
And now we have a chance to wake up America's soul and hope we can stir up enough indignation that something will be done. It's not money that we were looking for. We were looking to have America acknowledge that this war had been waged against American citizens.
Tulsa, Oklahoma is not as divided as it was in 1921, but even if reparations never become a reality, the city must still face its past in order to heal.
It was a great, great disaster. But American history is made up of disasters and plenty of them racial. Beginning in 1917 to 21, there were many riots, many race riots in the United States. Huge one in Atlanta, huge one in Washington, big one in Chicago, and several other smaller ones, Omaha, Nebraska, and various other places. So that you speak of East Europe as having pogroms. We had pogroms right here in this country. We are as barbaric as any of them.
We can learn that there's good and evil in everyone. We must work to overcome the evil things that we would do. We must learn, first of all, we must learn to respect all people.
And I forgive all the folks in the church, but you have to forgive all the folks for whatever they've done.